Well, I'm Margaret Hall for Infowars.com. We have a ton of news to get through. Let's just jump right in. We're going to start with Iran. This coming out of the news cycle today. I found this on Yahoo News. Iran's Supreme Leader Ayatollah Khamenei said today in Tehran that he's going to retaliate in the event that sanctions are approved through our U.S. Congress. Now, this is coming on the heels of Barack Obama leaving office. And the second that Trump is elected, this is so funny, folks. When I read this today, I'm like, yes, of course, right on. Finally, they're taking a step against Obama's measures. Of course, we know that our president lifted the sanctions against Iran, giving them free rein, stimulating their economy. Meanwhile, we have no check on the fact that they're possibly still building nuclear weapons. Now, I want to take you to what the U.S. House of Representatives did this week. They reauthorized the Iran Sanctions Act, or ISA, for 10 years. That's what we're looking at. Now, this Iranian measure, it would expire at the end of 2016. Had they not renewed it, it is pushing its way through the House now onto the Senate. And Iran and world powers, they concluded that this nuclear agreement, it's known as the JCPOA, last year, it was going to impose curbs on their nuclear program. And in return, all is well with their economy. Well, of course, we know that the White House, they believe this legislation, it's going to violate the nuclear pact that Obama would ultimately veto. Now, we know that Trump is less than 60 days away from assuming office. It cannot come soon enough, frankly, folks. And the fact that our Congress, our lawmakers, they're trying to ram this bill through to make sure that they can reimpose these sanctions. It looks like they're finally stepping up and doing their job. But Iran did not miss the opportunity to say, you know what, we're going to retaliate, whatever that means. I guess we're going to have to wait and see. We know what they did to a U.S. hostages in 1979 because they didn't get their way. I can only guess what retaliate means. But it looks like our Congress is finally doing their job and trying to reimpose those sanctions. Now, while Iran is chanting death to America on their streets, unfortunately, we have a similar situation here in the United States. We have anti-Trump protesters that are chanting for more cop killings after this spate of nationwide murders of police officers. Of course, we covered this article. Paul Joseph Watson, one of our own, put this up. It's on our website. These anti-Trump communist protesters, they were actually here in the city of Austin, and they were chanting. And I cannot believe that they were doing this in plain sight as police officers were in their cars nearby. This is what they were chanting, with some of them dressed in hammer and sickle face mask, like communists. The agitators, they shouted, F-U-C-K police, as they marched down the sidewalk, while others stuck up their middle fingers while cops were in nearby vehicles. What's better than one dead cop? Two dead cops, they could be heard shouting. And you know what? You'd think that this would be an arrestable offense, threatening the lives of police officers in front of them while your middle finger's up, basically saying that we're going to kill you. We want you all to die. We've had a spate of cop murders in this country, one alarmingly close to Austin and San Antonio. And these ambush-style attacks is what we're talking about against our law enforcement. And the Black Lives Matter activist that has inspired the entire movement, we know, was a convicted cop killer herself, which doesn't seem to have any impact on our current presidential administration, who, in fact, wants Black Lives Matter activists to come to the table and actually come into the White House and talk about how we can all come together and support the movement, despite them chanting that cops should die in our country. Now, Trump, I mentioned this earlier, this murdered San Antonio police officer, this man on Sunday, his name was Benjamin Marconi. He was a detective in San Antonio. He was actually writing a ticket to somebody, and he was shot and killed in the head, a random cop shooting. And where was our president? No word on Barack Obama reaching out to his family. The good news is, though, President-elect Donald Trump reportedly phoned his family, Officer Marconi's family. And Gregory Marconi, who was a spokesperson for the family, he wrote this on Facebook. It was not available for public viewing, but the San Antonio Express News picked it up. Donald Trump Jr., of course, retweeting it. This is what he had to say. He said, just got off the phone with the future President Trump. He sends his condolences to our family. And, you know, what, that's what a president should be doing, standing behind our fallen officers and their families and offering condolences for such a heinous, despicable crime, which is advocated by Black Lives Matter. Now, that's going on in the streets. And meanwhile, on our college campuses, places like this Hampshire College in Amherst, Massachusetts, they're flying their flags at half-mast. half staffed, excuse me, in the wake of the presidential election. I kid you not. And the spokesperson for the school, they actually had the audacity to say that it was going to provoke meaningful and respectful dialogue on the campus because they're flying their flags half staffed. I can't make this up, folks. It's actual news. The fact that we have a President Trump means that it's a time of grief and mourning for this ridiculous outfit. You know, I shudder to think what kids are paying in tuition to go to that school where they're mourning the election of a president. That's going on. Now, we understand here at InfoWars the role that the mainstream media played in trying to take down Donald Trump very unsuccessfully with their lies. They call us fake news, but in fact, they're the real fake news spouting these lies. We try to give you the real truth in real time as we find it. We work really hard. Our staff does this on the ground each and every day. And Donald Trump, I love this story coming out of the Wall Street Journal. He actually criticized, he hauled all of the TV network executives in a room, reportedly CNN President Jeff Zucker, Fox News co-president Jack Abernathy and Bill Shine, ABC News president James Goldstein, CBS News vice president Chris Isham, along with on-air bigwigs like Lester Holt, shame on you, Mr. Holt, by the way, CBS's Charlie Rose, ABC's George Stephanopoulos, and CNN's Wolf Blitzer, and he gave them a little talking to about their lies, about the hoodwinking that's gone on their shows, frankly. And we put this article up on Infowars.com where Trump, it's entitled Trump Tells TV Executives to Their Face, I Hate You, You Liars. Alex Jones breaks it down. Take a listen.
President-elect slams smug media in face-to-face at Trump Tower. We're in a room of liars. The deceitful, dishonest media who got it all wrong. Supposed to be an off-the-record meeting, but the Trump folks have confirmed this went on. He told them, look, I hate you. You hate me. Let's just be honest. You work for corporate execs that are fools. You've bankrupted yourselves. You have no credibility. And I just want to declare that you're scum. That's exactly what I'd tell them. The New York Times and stuff want to talk to me. I go, are you talking to me as a prop to pretend we're doing an interview? And I loved watching so-called journalists like Stephanopoulos and people scurrying out of there. And Wolf Blitzer looked like he'd been flogged with a cat or nine tails when he left. Donald Trump's media summit was an effing firing squad. He told Jeff Zucker, quote, I hate your network. Everyone at CNN is a liar and you should be ashamed. I'm sorry, this is just too good. Oh, it's too good. Trump knows exactly what to do. We must bankrupt these organizations. They're already financed by kingpins and drug dealers and every other criminal organization you can imagine. They want to bring the country down. You're going down. Whatever little sponsorship you've got left, everybody has to contact their sponsors and say, I will never use your product if I see your ad on there one more time. You want to bring down America? We're going to get in your face. We're going to lean on you and see how you like it, you little bullies. You bullied this country around a little too long.
Well, you talk about the fake corporate media scrambling to keep their heads on after that meeting. You know, it wasn't televised. I can only imagine how that went. And they have done a blatant attempt to silence anybody that criticizes them, calling us fake. You know, Dr. Paul in the Liberty Report, he did this amazing outline of the real fake news. And our own Alex Jones, he breaks that down for you in real time. Take a listen.
But for you to say that you're comfortable with fake news getting posted, that that's okay,
Tucker,
when you know that...
Define fake for me.
Well, you can't define fake.
Yes, you can.
What this
lies,
is about is left-leaning mainstream media blaming conservative media for losing the election, losing credibility, and losing readers. Their definition of fake news is anything that doesn't align with their leftist agenda.
Freedom of speech is staring down the barrel of a gun loaded by a cancer of global interests that have laid claim to the last remaining fragments of the First Amendment of the United States of America. RT reports former Congressman Ron Paul revealed a list of fake news journalists he claims are responsible for bogus wars and lies about Hillary Clinton's chances of winning the election. Journalists analysts from CNN, The New York Times, and The Guardian are included. According to the report on his website, Ron Paul Liberty Report, this list contains the culprits who told us that Iraq had weapons of mass destruction and lied us into multiple bogus wars. Paul claims the list is sourced and holds a lot more water than a list previously released by Melissa Zimdars, who is described by Zero Hedge as an ultra-liberal assistant professor of communications at Merrimack College. Zimdars' list in itself should be considered fake. A list containing actual fake news sites alongside true news-gathering alternative view sites that utilize a system of dissecting the mainstream narrative and its long history of fake reporting. Fake reporting is nothing new. Just ask Brian Williams.
After a ground fire incident in the desert during the Iraq war invasion, I made a mistake in recalling the events of 12 years ago. It did not take long to hear from some brave men and women in the air crews who were also in that desert. I want to apologize. I said I was traveling in an aircraft that was hit by RPG fire. I was instead in a following aircraft.
With the loss of the globalist foothold and the quiet death of the Smith-Mundt Act in 2013, propaganda is being waged on all fronts. George Orwell said, "Threats to freedom of speech, writing, and action, though often trivial in isolation, are cumulative in their effect and, unless checked, lead to a general disrespect for the rights of the citizen."
Is the Constitution a living document, open to interpretation? Or is it something that must be read strictly and adhered to regardless of the day?
You know, Scott, that is the question that is asked constantly of judges. And so to talk about strict interpretation or living constitution, those are not words I use. And they're not words that I think have much meaning.
The very concept of objective truth is fading out of the world. Lies will pass into history. George Orwell.
You know, when we first got in there, started looking around and didn't find anything, you get that kind of sinking feeling that, uh-oh. And then time went on, and then we got tips, you know, I'll never forget the tip that there was crates buried, you know, hidden in the Euphrates River. They found, maybe these are them, and they've sent frogmen and there's nothing there.
In our age, there is no such thing as keeping out of politics. All issues are political issues, and politics itself is a mass of lies, evasions, folly, hatred, and schizophrenia. George Orwell.
You have to represent all of the people, and the people have to believe that. You have to have the rule of law that applies to everyone, not just to some of the people.
For those of you who are concerned about my using personal email, I understand. And I am sure they will reach the same conclusion they did when they looked at my emails for the last year. There is no case here.
Now, speaking of fake news, because they're not happy that they were toppled and exposed and the real media got out, thanks in part to you on social media retweeting us. Facebook has been a critical component of getting out real news. And Zuckerberg, he's reportedly taken notice. He's done an all-out assault on fake news, what he's calling fake news, which is actually true news. And Facebook, they're saying that they're creating, this was in the New York Times, on the cover yesterday by Mike Isaac, Facebook said to create censorship tool to get back into China. So it looks like Zuckerberg, the social network, they've been quietly developing the software to suppress posts and appearing in people's news feeds in specific geographic areas, like here in the U.S., with anything they don't agree with. This according to three current and former Facebook employees who wanted to remain anonymous, not surprising there, because the tool is, quote, confidential. Apparently, they're wanting to break into the Chinese market. 1.4 billion people, they, you know, can't miss an opportunity to make a little money. Who cares about censorship, right? I mean, it's all in, you know, it's what they do anyway, frankly. I want to take you to this. The suppression software has been contentious within Facebook, which is separately grappling with what should or should not be shown to its users after the American presidential election. reactions, unexpected outcome, spurred questions over fake news on the social network. They are not happy at all that they could not accurately suppress in real time what was being said on social media, exposing the Clinton lies, exposing the Clinton camp, that machine of corruption. You guys did a heck of a job getting on social media. You know, we were at the tip of the spear with this, and we really tried to pierce through pretty successfully, I might add, InfoWars and Breitbart in particular, and Facebook is not too happy about it. It looks like they're partnering with a Chinese company to monitor popular news stories. That's a shocker right there. Now, as they're scrambling to squelch fake news, the Democratic National Committee, of course, is in shambles given what happened with Donna Brazile. What a nightmare there. It looks like she was fired from CNN as well. And she had to step down because it turns out she wasn't doing too many ethical things over there. They're looking for a new leader right now. Also on the cover of the New York Times, you know, I can't pass up a good story here. Keith Ellison is being considered for the top job, and he's not without controversy. Of course, he is a Muslim. He's in Congress representing Minnesota. He defended Louis Farrakhan in the 90s, saying that he was not an anti-Semite, trying to position himself to represent his congressional delegation as a moderate. We, of course, know that Ellison is not a moderate. Very poor choice here, but hey, they got to throw up somebody.